Now, if you have a Bible, you might be turning to Matthew chapter 7 while I begin to sketch this picture. Matthew chapter 7. And you'll read there a very interesting story about two houses. Matthew chapter 27, and I'm beginning at verse 24. Matthew chapter 27, or rather Matthew chapter 7, beginning at verse 24. In the 7th chapter of Matthew, beginning at verse 24, you'll read these words, and Christ is speaking. Jesus said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them, shall be likened to a wise man that built his house upon a rock. And he said, the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew upon that house, and it fell not, because it was founded upon a rock. And then he said, everyone that heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man that built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew on that house. And he said, it fell, and great was the fall of it. And when he had finished these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. For he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes and Pharisees. Yes, they were astonished because Jesus was the most radical preacher that ever lived. They were astonished at his doctrine because he spoke with authority. Jesus never said, we may reasonably suppose. Jesus never said, it is highly probable. Jesus never said, it seems. Jesus said, it is doubtful, but we can be reasonably sure. He never talked that way. Jesus always said, it is this way. And when anybody crossed him and gave the tradition of the forefathers, Jesus said, but I say unto you, but I say unto you, he was the most radical preacher that ever lived, and he spoke with authority, and not as the scribes. The scribes were always guessing. You see, the poor scribe had no final, infallible authority. He had to just trust in different translations to get his authority. Now, Jesus spoke with great authority. I say he was the most radical preacher that ever lived. He ignored the theology of his day. He ignored the tradition of the religious leaders of his day. He was non-sectarian in the way he presented the gospel, the way he presented his preaching and his illustrations. He used common language anyone could understand. And he never preached to the head. He always aimed at the heart. He aimed at the heart. He was a radical preacher. And he spoke with authority and not as the scribes. Now, in this story, he tells about two men. And about two different kinds of houses. I'm going to draw a few tonight, these houses. The first, he said, was a house built by a wise man. And it was built upon a rock. And when the rains descended and the floods came and the wind beat upon that house, it wouldn't fall down. Because it was founded, you see, upon a rock. Then he spoke about a foolish man that built his house upon the sand. And that man's house fell down. Now I'd like to make a few remarks about these two houses and see if we can find a type of salvation in these two houses. Because these two houses represent two different kinds of men and two different kinds of religion.
One man's house is the wise man, the man that built his house upon the rock. And Simon Peter is very carefully to tell us in the Bible that the rock is Jesus Christ. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Bible is very careful to tell us that the spiritual rock is Christ. And this man built his house upon a rock. He was a saved man. The other man that I'm going to draw over here in just a minute was a lost man. He built his house upon the shifting sands of speculation. He built his house upon the shifting sands of philosophy and science, ideas that change once or twice every 3 or 4 days. He built his house upon the ideology of his day, the prevailing philosophy of the people of his generation, which changes as soon as that generation is gone. One man counted upon his salvation for the sands of time that sift and change and blow and get in your eyes, and the other man counted his salvation by building his house upon a rock. And the Bible tells us that rock was Christ. So this evening, let's examine these two houses and see if we can find out where they are alike and also where they differ. Two houses, one built upon the rock, the other built upon sand. First of all, let's notice that these two houses outwardly appeared the same. The outward appearance was identical. You probably couldn't have told by looking at the two houses which one of them was going to stand the blows and tests of time. Outwardly, they looked the same. So today, many people who are unsaved put on as good an outward appearance as people who are saved, or even better. Outwardly, these houses both appeared the same, and a casual bystander or observer could not have told you the difference between the construction of these two houses. Outwardly, they appeared the same. Something else about these two houses. Both the builders of these houses had good intentions when they built it. A man said one time, he said, "Do you think God will hold you responsible for what you don't know?" "Yes, of course he will, if he has as much sense as psychologists." Psychologists don't judge a man for what he knows, they judge him for what he's capable of knowing. And God Almighty will judge all of us for what we could have known if our hearts had been right. Not just for what we know. That's just a duck. That's just a dodge. That's somebody trying to find an alibi to do something they want to do. Now these houses, both were built by men that had good intentions. You never would have gotten the man that built the house that fell. You would have never gotten him to say that he intended for it to fall. He intended for it to stand just like the other man did. Why, if you'd approached these two builders in the process of building, one of them said, "Well, my material is just good as the other fella. My location is just as good." Of course it wasn't, but he thought it was. And you know, they say, "Well, if the fella means well, he'll get by. What about the heathen?" All that nonsense. Yes, well, this man meant well, and he tried to do right, and he wanted to do right. And both these builders were just sincere as they could be. But there was one terrible difference between these two buildings. Now, these buildings not only outwardly appeared the same, and they were not only built with good intentions, but further, both builders probably worked hard to build them. I don't imagine this man that built his house upon the sand loafed any more than the other man loafed. They might have both been hard workers. Why, you have many church workers today that work just as hard to save people, or even harder. You have many people in many type of religious activities and endeavors that are just working their brains out. They're like Martha, they're cumbered about with much serving. I remember one time a woman came to a pastor and myself during a revival meeting, and she was about ready to lose her mind through overwork, church work, and we asked her if she'd been spending too much time in prayer. No, she said she had no time to pray. We said, "How many souls have you won in the last year?" "Oh, I haven't won anybody to Christ." We said, "Well, how much do you read the Bible?" "Oh, I haven't had time to read the Bible, I've been so busy." Now that poor soul was busy working. She was cumbered about with much serving, like Martha. She was a hard worker, and I imagine both these men were hard builders and worked their brains out trying to make a good building, but one of them just didn't make it. And you can work till you sweat and be on the wrong track, and one of these builders was. But he was a hard worker. Yes, these buildings were similar in that both their builders were hard workers, both had good intentions. And that isn't all. Both these buildings were put to the test. You heard what the Bible said. It said the rains descended. It said the rains descended and said the floods came. And the winds blew upon those houses. And one of them fell. And great was the fall of it. Now both buildings were put to the test. You can't tell whether or not a thing is right until it's tested. Let me ask you something. Whatever religion you profess, how does it stand the test of the Bible? If your religion can't meet the test of the book that was here before you were born, and will be here after you die, how do you figure it's the right religion? Let me ask you something else. Whatever you profess to believe in, will your religion stand the test of those with you live with, that you live with? What about the people you live with? What do they think of your religion? Does it meet their demands? Well, if it doesn't, I wouldn't give you very much for it. Something isn't any good, but it's been tested. Well, one time a preacher was looking through an old woman's Bible, and he found, after nearly every other verse, two little letters. T.P. 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 was written after nearly half the verses in the Bible. And the preacher said to this gobby old woman, he said, "Pardon me, Sister So-and-so," he said, "Why do you have this T.P. written after these verses?" She said, "Well, preacher, that means tested and proved. Tested and proved. Tested and proved." Yes, sir, both these houses were tested. Both these houses were put to the test. Yes, the good old King James Bible is tried and proven. One time a young man said to his godly Christian mother, he said, "Mother, you know the scholars say that good old Bible isn't any good anymore." He says, "You know, Mother, the scholars said you have to have the original Hebrew and Greek to understand it." And his old Christian mother said, "Tut, tut, laddie." She said, "Don't you mind the great man." She said, "I've translated a few of them promises myself." And that's true. The Bible is tested and proved. And these two houses were tested. They were put to the test. And the great difference between them is that one stood the test and the other one didn't. There is one other difference between these two houses, and of course this is the greatest difference. These two houses, the biggest difference between them was an invisible difference. You couldn't see it. And that's the difference in the two kinds of so-called salvation. Salvation that is real is the hidden man of the heart, the Holy Spirit, in the heart of a regenerated individual. That's one kind of salvation. The other kind of so-called salvation, often called religion by well-meaning people, is outward appearance, it's works. But inside, there's nothing. The difference between these two houses, when you get right down to it, was an invisible difference. It was something inside, it was something hidden. Now the difference between salvation and religion is simply this. Religion is what a man does that he thinks will merit favor with God. Religion is what a man does or professes to do to get by the judgment that'll never get him by. Salvation is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. For the Bible says, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now, my friend, let me be quite frank just a minute. Let me be quite personal with you by your television set just a minute. Are you saved? Have you ever received God's Son? Inside your heart, inside your body, is the Holy Spirit dwelling? Are you sure the Holy Spirit dwelling inside? Here are two houses. Those houses represent your life. Some of you people, when the time comes for the testing and the winds begin to blow and the rain comes pouring down and the floods come up, you're going to have nothing left to your life but a wreckage. And some of you people that have founded your house and your home and your life upon the rock Christ Jesus are going to stand. Now, do you say, well, that's very well. Now, how do I do it? How do I receive Christ? It's easy. All you have to do is just bow your head right there by the television set and ask him to save you. Why don't you do it right now? All you have to do is just bow your head and say, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Please save me. Please save me. That's all. Men and women, he won't turn you down. He's not going to turn you down. The reason why most people never get saved is they don't realize they're lost. But if you know you're lost right now, just bow your head and say, Lord Jesus, please save me. I'm a sinner. And he'll save you. He won't turn you down. He loved you enough to die for you, and he will not turn you down. And say, if you do receive him, will you write me and let me know about your decision? The Bible says there's rejoicing among the angels of God over one sinner that repents, over 99 just persons which have no need of repentance. And I'd rejoice. I'd be more than happy if you would receive the Lord as your Savior. He's my Savior. Will you accept him too? If you will, let me know about it. TV for Christ, Panama City, Florida, will reach me.